say.
Yeah. Preston Jones is having tests.
Okay.
Joe Carroll has entered hospice care.
Oh.
And that hospice care is at Wustoff.
Well, it's called Rockledge Regional or something like that.
Praise the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Let us come to him with thanksgiving. Let us sing psalms of praise to him. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God, the Father, through him. The Bible has many verses on gratitude and thankfulness, and we have much to be thankful for. As we enter this week of Thanksgiving, where we're getting together with family, friends, preparing meals, and we're thinking about things that we should be thankful for, let us always remember the greatest gift we have to be thankful for, Jesus. Welcome to Good Shepherd, and good morning.
Good morning.
We'd like to welcome you this morning to Good Shepherd Presbyterian Church, to those of you here in the sanctuary and also online. My name is Christy Cruz, if you don't know me, and it's so good to have you here. Good Shepherd has a wonderful tradition of welcoming visitors and also those who may have come back and haven't been here for a while. We'd like to ask that if you're visiting today, or if maybe you're back after not being here for a while, that you stand and tell us who you are and where you're from. And I'll start over in this section. Are there any visitors? Well, it's good to see all of your faces, the regulars. How about over here? Any visitors? Good to see you all, too. And how about over here? Everybody looks familiar to me, so welcome. Just a reminder that we'll be sharing spoken prayer requests at the end of the service. And also, this is a bulletinless Sunday, a bulletin-free Sunday in honor of America's Recycle Day. So I want to highlight just a few announcements. There were some before the sanctuary service started. We have a new Sunday school class for grades kindergarten through six. It started and it meets at 10 a.m. on Sundays. If you need more information or are interested in bringing some children to that, see Carla Frederick. The Adult Ministry Christmas Party is on December 5th at 11:30 at Olive Garden, and you can see Pam Seaver Payne if you're interested in registering for that. We have a sign-up sheet in the hallway for the Dickens Dinner, which is December 17th, so we'd encourage you all to sign up for that as soon as possible. And also on the Adult Ministry Christmas Party, Pam needs to know by December 1st if you're planning to attend that. We also have some birthdays today, or this week. Brenda Reynolds is on the 21st, Ed Rapsick is on the 22nd, and Damian Necht is on the 25th. So happy birthday to all of you all. And at this time, I'd like to introduce Pastor Scott, who has a moment for mission.
Thank you, Christy. You see here, Operation Christmas Child boxes stacked at the front. And I want to let you know that y'all responded to the youths getting the word out about this, and y'all responded quickly. And we have 25 boxes that are going right at the close of worship to get into the hands of kids, boys and girls. And so thank you for that gift. Also, I will note on the Dickens dinner, if you're like me and you have a hard time holding things in short-term memory, and you're like, I want to sign up for Dickens dinner, but I don't know if I'll remember it by the end of the service, go ahead and get up and go out in the hallway and sign up. That'll be all right. That'll be all right. Okay, thank you. graduate recognition.
Oh, graduate recognition.
Yes, short-term memory.
Alternative Christmas, that's your mission moment.
Alternative Christmas is my mission moment, not the boxes. Okay, remember what I said about the boxes. But Alternative Christmas is coming up on December 10th, 3rd? 3rd, on December 3rd. And at Alternative Christmas, you have the opportunity to support the missions of the church. And you, the way you do it with Alternative Christmas is you give a gift on behalf of somebody else toward one of those missions, and then we equip you with a little card, and you fill it out, and you give it to them on Christmas, and you say, this was given on your behalf. And so I invite you to support the missions of the church in that way as a gift, and it's a wonderful way to do it. Yeah, anybody have anybody it's hard to buy a gift for? This is a great solution for that. So please support Alternative Christmas. Thank you. Now we have graduate recognition. I recognize one graduate that's sitting in our congregation. Amy, come on up. And then our other graduate is Sam, but Sam was not able to be here. I got an indication that he might not be able to be here. And Amy, you are not a graduate of high school.
No.
You are, well, you are, but not recently. Many years. So please come and share with us what you achieved, what you just did.
Thank you. Hi, yes, good morning. I graduated from the University of Florida. I got my math, yes, go Gators. Even though they didn't come through last night, that's all right. It happens. But I got my master's degree in material science and engineering, as well as an engineering leadership certificate. So yes, it was fun, and I got to go to Gainesville for graduation. Because I figured, why not? It was my third time going to campus, so. And I even got to go to homecoming, and they did win that football game, so that was fun.
Yeah. Outstanding.
Yeah, thank you.
And Amy, I will say, during the course of your time in studies, on very often in meetings, which you were faithfully come to meetings and be a part, even though you were doing all those studies, I heard you say, well, I have to go study for this, or I have to go do that.
Yeah.
And so it was a very real part of your life.
Yes,
last few years. And congratulations.
Yeah.
And this
you.
Is a gift from the church for
Aww,
you.
Thank you so much. Thank you all. Thank you.
Please join me in saying what we believe with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. Third day he arose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn is Let All Things Now Living, and it's number 554.
Fashioned and made us protect.
confess our sins. Let us lay before God and one another the distances between us, the impatience, idolatries, and lack of compassion that form our confessions this day. For if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. Yet in mercy, God will forgive us and renew us. Gracious and welcoming God, have mercy on your people. We do not heed your word each day in all that we say and do. We do not see our neighbors, families, and friends as beloved children whom you have made. In your mercy, forgive us, for we repent of our ways and look to your power to heal us and raise us up, so that at the last you will gather us to you and give us peace. Amen. The reign of God has come near. The repentant will be judged with righteousness. You are forgiven. Be filled with hope, believing in the power of the risen Christ to bring you to new life. Rejoice and believe.
Glory be to the Father.
You pass the peace of Christ.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you. Now, it says prayer of peace. I have a little prayer.
That's a little song.
But can I do that prayer? Would you rather I don't?
There's the prayer of intercession that comes right after that.
Okay.
For our prayers of intercession, pray for the following who are friends or members of this church: Preston, Joe, Chuck's family, Bill L., Kevin, Jimmy, Sal, and Ed. In our prayer of intercession, let us pray for the needs of the world, saying, God of hosts, hear our prayer. Restore us, O gods of hosts. Let your face shine that we may be saved. For your beloved chosen people, the vine you brought out of Egypt, God of hosts, hear our prayer. For the church of Jesus Christ, your beloved Son, God of hosts, for martyrs, saints, and prophets persecuted for doing your will, God of hosts. For all who are suffering through sickness or oppression, God of hosts. For the coming of your kingdom with justice and peace for all, God of hosts. Turn again, O God of hosts. Look down from heaven and see. Have regard for your people through Christ the vine, in whom we are the branches. Amen. And now we'll pray the prayer the Lord has taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now God's tithes and our offerings of love. We ask your blessing on these tithes and these gifts of love to the work of your mission, the work of your church. Amen.
To make
Amen. You may be seated. And now, Miss Eleni.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
I'm Miss Eleni. I hope this will stay. I'm here with today's children's sermon, and today I'm going to talk about Thanksgiving. And for those watching virtually, you're just going to have to pretend to eat the snack. So, as many of you know, the story of Thanksgiving, it's a beautiful story about the pilgrims who came from England because they wanted to pray the way that they wanted to pray. And when they arrived, they didn't have food, they didn't have a house, they didn't have houses, and it was cold, it was freezing cold, and half of the pilgrims died. But God sent Squanto and Samoset to help them, and they taught him everything. They taught them everything about planting and fishing and collecting nuts and berries and all of that. And by the time the next harvest rolled around, they had enough food to have a feast for 3 days. And they made it a day of Thanksgiving as a way to thank God. Of course, my grandma Diane knows more about that than I do. But that's the Thanksgiving story in a nutshell. So I'm going to ask my youth to help pass out these snacks to the congregation. And as they're passing it out, I'll read you what is in it. Come on up, youth. Make sure you don't forget the choir. Okay, and so if you'd like one of these papers, I'll leave them outside my door. This is a blessing mix, and you can make this at home, virtual people. So you get an ice cream cone or a sugar cone, which is shaped like a cornucopia, which is a symbol of our nation's abundance. Then there are pretzels. And if you look at a pretzel, they look like arms folded in prayer, which is a freedom sought by those who founded our country. The candy corn represents the sacrifice of the pilgrims' first winter. Settlers survived on a few kernels of corn a day. The marshmallows are a reminder of all the snow that the pilgrims endured their first winter. The raisins are representative of harvest gifts from our bountiful land. The M&Ms are memories of those who came before us to guide us to a blessed future. And the Czech cereal is a symbol of the friendship between the Indians and the pilgrims. So as you enjoy this snack, think about Thanksgiving and think about things that you're thankful for and that you can thank God for. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. We've got a beautiful nation and friends and family and more food than we could ever dream of. Please watch over those that are sick and hurt and help them find relief in you. Please watch over us as we have no school this week and help us think about all that we have to be thankful for. And let us come back to church safe and healthy next week. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. Bye, everybody. I love you. Happy Thanksgiving. Enjoy the snack.
Amen. Thank you, choir. That was beautiful. I'm kind of thankful for this little reminder about Thanksgiving, the little note that goes with these bags. It's kind of cute. And it also checks two boxes as we are going through all the ideas that you submitted, things that we can start in the church that would be helpful. Snack food during the sermon was one of them. So
it's a joke.
Our passage today comes from the book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 5, 1 through 7. We will read that in just a moment. Isaiah, first Isaiah, is roughly the same time period as our passage from Hosea last week. But Isaiah's ministry is located in the southern kingdom, that of Judah. At this time, you will recall from last week that the northern kingdom is being pummeled or has recently been pummeled by the foreign country Assyria. Assyria, its expansionistic tendencies well known, is also, it turns out, a pressing concern for the people of Judah in the south. And in light of this threat, King Ahaz, not to be confused with King Ahab of the north, that we talked about a couple weeks ago, King Ahaz agrees to a pact of sorts with Babylon and perhaps even Egypt as well. But getting into bed with foreign powers and foreign gods is not, well, kosher, to say it briefly. For this reason, and for other reasons that we will get to in just a minute, God sends God's prophet Isaiah with a message for the people of Judah. This parable poem that we are about to read takes the form of a love song, similar to the writings of the Song of Songs. I believe Isaiah uses this form, a love song, to draw his audience in so that they would at least initially open their ears and perhaps to truly consider hearing what he had to say. Isaiah's message comes in the form of a lover's vineyard, which sadly does not bear good fruit. Hence the sermon title, Sour Grapes, Bad Fruit from God's People. Isaiah chapter 5, starting at verse 1. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste, and it shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds, for they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Isaiah was prophesying, relaying God's word during a time of great turmoil, during a time of war and a time of rumors of war. Like most prophets, Isaiah's message was, well, a hard word to hear. What were they doing? Well, in addition to foreign alliances, Isaiah uses, well, Hebrew wordplay to highlight the heart of their deficiency. Someone asked me before worship if I was getting in the weeds again. I think Hebrew wordplay qualifies as getting in the weeds a little bit. So we'll do a little bit of in the weeds. Wordplay to describe poetically the message of God. It comes in verse 7, right at the end of our reading. It says, God expected justice but saw bloodshed. God wanted righteousness but heard a cry. You may ask, well, how is that poetic or clever even? Well, it's only revealed as such in the original language, that of Hebrew. In Hebrew, the word for justice, well, it sounds like the Hebrew word for bloodshed. And the Hebrew word for righteousness, well, it sounds like the Hebrew word for cry. Here's a slide to help. God expected, that is, God wanted, mishpat is the Hebrew word for justice. God wanted mishpat, but instead God finds in Judah not mishpat, justice, but mispach, bloodshed, violence. A similar sounding word with a meaning completely different, almost the opposite meaning, really. Isaiah uses Hebrew wordplay to communicate what is wrong in Israel, what is wrong in Judah. Isaiah is not using a homophone, which is the same word with two meanings, but rather uses these similar sounding words to drive his point home. God wants mishpat, justice, but finds mispach, violence. And now many years later, in using a completely different language, we today often still confuse justice with vengeance or getting even or bloodshed. I mean, how many Hollywood movies equate the two? I mean, so many action movies has this as the basic premise, the basic theme. Recent movies, which you may or may not have seen, The Northmen last year, John Wick Chapter 4, I think that was this year, or any John Wick movie for that matter. I like the one where they killed his dog, which was, you know, just terrible. The Batman, I don't know if anybody watched that. But the first words out of the Batman, that was 2022, the first words out of the Batman's mouth is as he emerges from the shadows, and he's asked by the man that he's there to get, the guy says, the guy who's beating somebody else up, who are you? And the Batman says, I am vengeance. And I'm like, oh, I got to put that in. I got to put that in here. Classic movies have for a long time equated justice with bloodshed or violence or vengeance. Classic movies, Gladiator, Taken, the Death Wish series, you got to go back to the 70s for that. Even Star Wars, The Wrath of Khan was all about getting back at. Star Trek, what'd I say, Star Wars? Star Trek. Even still, The Princess Bride, and that's in your kids' collection. Intego Monteo, I can't even say his name, he's living to get revenge. He's living to get justice, as he would call it. Movies written with a sense of justice that is essentially equated with vengeance, it's an enormously popular theme in the movies. So much so that our thinking on the word justice is probably profoundly impacted. So that leaves us with the obvious question, what kind of justice is God speaking of if the prophet's use of the word justice is clearly not a retribution-based justice? While the word justice can be used to talk about retributive justice, if I can coin that word, in our English language, it can be used that way, in which a person is punished for their wrongdoings. Most of the time in the Bible uses the word justice to refer to something that is, well, completely different from that. And so let's just add the word restorative justice. The Bible's talking about restorative justice. This is the justice God is looking for in Israel and Judah, restorative justice in which those who are hurt or wronged or vulnerable are being restored, are being lifted up, are being, well, helped. Restorative justice is the biblical norm for the word justice, and it has very little to do with vengeance or violence. So in our passage, God wants to see restorative justice, but instead, God witnesses the opposite. God witnesses bloodshed. God witnesses violence. That is mishpat versus mispach. Do you see how Isaiah's wordplay really brings to light the crossed wires in people's thinking both then and now? And speaking of now, we're going to talk more on that application in just a moment. But let's move to the second use of wordplay in our passage in verse 7, for it's striking as well. God wants tzedekah, righteousness. God wants righteousness, the Hebrew word tzedekah, but he found tzedekah. Just don't say the D. He's looking for tzedekah, God is, but he found tzedekah, which means an outcry of distress. The use of these two Hebrew words really intrigues me. It draws me to compare and to contrast God's call to righteousness with our own referenced, often referenced, sense of righteous indignation. Just like it is easy still in today's world to confuse justice with the idea of vengeance or violence or bloodshed, it is also easy to confuse righteousness with a holier-than-thou attitude, which very well may cause another to express an outcry of distress. How often do we equate righteousness with righteous indignation? Consider the well-known accusation, "You are so self-righteous." You know, when you hear that, well, it clearly communicates something. It communicates that a person is smug or judgmental or angry. But do you really think in any way, shape, or form that that is the righteousness that God calls us to? No. No, unfortunately, we today, well, we still make some of the same mistakes that Israel and Judah made so many years ago. And if we don't know what God means by justice, if we don't even know what God means by righteousness, then how can we ever hope to live into them? In the Bible, righteousness refers to a state of communal moral good, in which we treat those around us with decency and fairness, recognizing that all of them are made in the image of God just like you and I are. What I want to point out clearly is that righteousness is inherently communal. Conversely, an attitude of, say, righteous indignation, that's inherently individualistic. Righteousness involves others. Righteous indignation is all about you. Friends, 3,000 years ago, this was Hebrew wordplay because the Hebrew words sounded similar. Since then, 3,000 years have passed, and this is just so interesting, we are speaking a completely different language, where justice and bloodshed don't sound anywhere alike. Righteousness and outcry of distress don't sound anything alike. They're in English, they're very different things, and yet we still confuse the two. We continue to confuse the word justice, because in English, justice can mean something base, something like vengeance or getting even or bloody vendetta. We use that word that way, but is supposed to mean, it often does mean in the Bible, something lofty, help for others, fairness and equity for all. Righteousness, it can mean something lofty, living in perfect relationship with each other, living righteously, or it can mean something base, like individual righteous indignation. So close and yet so far. Friends, God's use of justice is about living justly on behalf of others. It is distinctly not about getting even. Isaiah spells it out clearly at the beginning of his book. Isaiah 1:17 says this: learn to do good, seek justice, reprove the ruthless, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. And secondly, righteousness has nothing to do with an angry, myopic lashing out at others. Quite the contrary, righteousness in the Old Testament is the fulfillment of the demands of relationship with and for each other. The fulfillment of the demands of relationship. Righteousness is all about relationship. In fact, the word cannot be understood outside of the construct of relationship. When God or humanity fulfills the conditions conferred upon him or her by a relationship, he or she, in Old Testament terms, is righteous. Now, righteousness lived rightly actually may cause verbal expressions, but these won't be cries of distress, friends. Rather, they will be expressions of celebration, of praise, of thanksgiving. The very things that you hopefully will be uttering this Thursday around your tables with those you eat and share Thanksgiving. What I'm saying is, living righteously, well, it lifts up a community in which it is practiced. It does not drag it down and break it apart. Being righteous is a very good thing for everyone in the picture, not just the individual. Isaiah's Hebrew wordplay brings depth and causes us to reconsider what we thought we knew about justice and righteousness. So let's jump back into the main storyline to see what is coming to pass because of this confusion between Mishpat and Mispach, between Tzedekah and Tzedekah. Friends, here is the thing about prophets. No one typically wants to hear what they have to say. So prophets, out of necessity, sometimes, well, they develop strategies of drawing people in. They know people don't want to hear what they have to say. Isaiah's prophecy starts out as a love song. Everyone loves a love song. Maybe even more than a parfait does everyone love a love song. A love song. Most people can resonate with a love song. Further, Isaiah's love song is about a beloved and a vineyard. Most people in that day could also resonate with agriculture and the effort that is involved in working the land. Let me sing to my beloved. Our story begins as a love song with an agricultural setting, something that really connects with folks. The context allows the audience to connect to the message before they realize bitterly that Isaiah is talking about them. The owner of the vineyard pours out love and hard work into his vineyard. The gardener prepared the land, caring for the vines. Growing grapevines takes time. And I should note, a vineyard, well, it benefits the whole community, not just the gardener. Fun fact, did you know a single acre of vineyard can produce 1 to 10 tons of grape a year? 3 to 5 is considered optimal, but that sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? I know some of you are going to check, and I want you to look it up. So a small hilltop vineyard spoken of in our passage has the capacity to produce Well, for a community. It's not just for the single landowner. That's too many grapes. Everyone in the community will enjoy the fresh grapes and wine that emerge from this vineyard. The communal nature of a vineyard is an important detail as we later find out what this story is about. Now, the owner of this vineyard has done everything that needs to be done. But mysteriously, tragically even, the vineyard does not produce what it should. Just to connect the dots, it produces mispach, not mishpat. It produces se'eka, not sedeka. It produces sour grapes, not sweet. And the love song takes a turn. Isaiah stops talking about his beloved and starts speaking the message of his beloved. And we should observe that the story begins in the voice of the third person, but at verse 3 of our passage, the voice of the frustrated gardener himself, it breaks into the story, proposing to destroy the worthless vineyard as deliberately as he had once built it. I'll start at verse 3 and reread. "And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard than I have not done in it? When I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do with my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns." Although the tenor of Isaiah's message is growing dark, the hearers of Isaiah's words, well, they're still drawn into the story. They are a people of the land. And practically, if a vineyard doesn't produce, what good is it? They can't fault the gardener for what is happening. He has done what any good gardener could do. And the hearers, well, they're now invested in the story, in this very relatable story. But then Isaiah drops a bomb. The gardener says, verse 6, "I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it." And the people kind of stop and let that sink in. And they say, wait a second. Light bulbs are starting to go off in the hearers' minds. It is one thing for a gardener to remove a hedge, to take down a wall, to not prune or to hoe, to allow briars and thorns to grow, but it is quite another to command the skies to not give forth rain. The prophet tips his hand. This discouraged gardener of grapevines is none other than God. And then immediately after this revelation, Isaiah unpacks the meaning of the story. Verse 7, "For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel." And when those who are listening hear him say this, well, there's kind of a collective sigh of relief. You see, these are the people of Judah to whom Isaiah is talking in the south. They think, yes, yes, of course, Israel in the north. They are indeed our brothers and sisters, but they have long been, well, the relative who kind of always got themselves in trouble. It is true what the gardener says of them, poor, poor northerners. And then Isaiah wipes the relief right off of their faces as he continues his parable poem. The rest of verse 7, "And the people of Judah are his pleasant planting." And they say, no, no, Isaiah's talking about us as well. That is how it is with prophets. You don't want to be the subject of their message. It is always more comfortable to hear a prophet's words from the perspective of them talking about someone else. We, of course, are removed from that time and place by literally thousands of years. But is Isaiah's message still relevant for us today? Even though we wouldn't want it to be. Friends, is Isaiah talking to us as well? Of course, the story isn't really about a vineyard. It is about God and God's people. Despite all the tender, loving care given by God, wild, sour, bad grapes grew as the people's fruit. Despite God's covenants and care, Israel and Judah turned away from God time and time again. They were not righteous. They were not just. And guess what? We do the same things. As you prayed the prayer of confession, did you take note of the words? Isaiah says to Judah, you can continue in your sour grape lifestyle, but look at Israel in the north. The hedge can and has come down, and Assyria is rolling in. Judah, do you hear me? Like Israel in the north and Judah in the south, sometimes we just repeatedly, well, we get it wrong. Sometimes our basic understanding of the way of things is just not well conceived. Sometimes the justice we advocate for is more like that of the movies. Sometimes the righteousness we covet, well, is not the communal kind. The prophet Isaiah declares God wants restorative justice, not retributive justice. God wants communal righteousness, not individuals who ignore the cries of others and puff themselves up by their own sense of self-importance. Friends, here is what is at stake. Your families, your communities, your country, this world. If God's people bear sour grapes, what does the gardener have to share with the world? The gardener has invested himself in the vines, feeding and watering and pruning and nurturing. The gardener is doing the work toward producing something to be consumed, enjoyed, embraced by the gardener's community, aka the world. The quality of our fruit, friends, is vital. If God's people bear sour grapes, what does the gardener have to share with the world? Good fruit is indeed not just what the gardener wants. Friends, it is what the world needs. Amen. I invite you to stand with me and to sing, My Country, 'Tis of Thee. Friends, acting holier than thou is not righteousness. Getting even is not justice. Friends, go this week and produce fruit that is worthy to be shared here in the community in which we all live. Amen.